Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner. In this episode, I'm going to do something that I basically never do, and that is talk about a specific C++ Standard Committee paper. This particular paper has been accepted by the C++ Standard Committee into C++ 26. It is not currently documented on CBP reference, nor in the draft C++ standard. We pretty much have to go straight to the source if we want to discuss the nature of this feature. Now, this feature is called Define Static String Object Array. You can see that this was last updated June 20th of 2025, and it is paper P3491R3. I'm going to take just a moment to make sure you know about wg21.link. This is quite the service that is used by the C++ Standard Committee and by people who care about these things. So for any paper, you can put in wg21.link/p whatever, the paper number, and it will give you the link to that paper. Or you can do /github, and you can get the GitHub status of the thing. So with the handy WG21 service, we can see that in fact, this thing was accepted back in February. And the issue was, let's see, closed, I guess, back on June 21st. Now, interestingly, this does rely on reflection. If you're a fan of this channel, you know that I don't cover any topic until there is some sort of example that I can illustrate for you. And we can do that. On Compiler Explorer, we do have, in fact, Clang reflection fork. And if we put this thing in C++ 26 mode, then we can use this define static string feature. And you can see here where I already have an example typed up. I had a pretty much out of body experience while I was working on this example. I started typing it up and then I was going back to the paper for more information. And I saw this example. Apparently, the authors of this paper referenced talks that I have given on this topic before. And oh goodness, have I talked about this topic before. This talk, which was first given at C++ Now, and I think it's fair to say this ended up becoming a highly influential talk because constexpr all the things was quoted and referenced by so many other papers and talks over the last 8 years since we presented this, Ben and I together. It was first presented in May of 2017. Then there was episode 313, the constexpr problem that took me 5 years to fix. And this one directly refers back to the main problem that Ben and I had. Namely, that is knowing the size of a compile time thing such that you can persist the compile time thing to runtime. If you're trying to solve a problem of unknown bounds, well, that's not really fair to say. If it's being done at compile time, then you clearly know the bounds of the problem. It's just that the bounds are annoyingly complicated to compute, is really the thing. So you want to write plain, clean, simple C++ code that executes at compile time, and then just magically know the size of that thing. This talk, understanding the constexpr two-step, moving from compile time to runtime, from C++ on C of 2024, is the video that the authors of the paper were specifically referencing. Let's go ahead and take this example. I want to build some sort of string at compile time, and I want that thing to persist to runtime. Doing this before define static string and before define static array was annoyingly difficult because you basically had to manually copy the thing into an oversized array because you can't have a constexpr string. If I were to do something like this, I'm going to get a compile time failure. The error is going to be data that was allocated at compile time was not free to compile time. Must be initialized by a constant expression. The pointer to subobject of heap allocated object is not a constant expression. GCC gives a better error here. So what do you do? And like I said, the traditional solution is annoying. You have to construct the string in a constexpr function and then copy it while still inside constexpr context into an appropriately sized array and then return that thing. So it would ultimately look something kind of like this. This solution has its own set of problems, but it does work. The main problem is that if the string that you're trying to make into a static string is more than 255 characters, you'll get a compile time error, and then you have to kind of manually resize this thing to some sort of maximum value, but at least we have a zero initialized array, and then we can do something somewhat intelligent with it. So we can do something kind of like this, and we can look at the disassembly and we can see what the compiler did for us. We have hello there long string followed by 232 zeros, because that's exactly what we asked it to do. But it can take a pointer to this thing and send that directly to puts, and we can print it, and that's great. But it takes us multiple steps and it takes a lot of effort to do this efficiently. Okay, we're going to delete these examples and we're going to focus on what define static string gives us. Define static string basically does all that for us. There's also define static array. Now, what makes both of these interesting is that neither one of them relies on a string or an array. They both basically work with ranges. So any range-like thing. That's pretty cool. We're going to have to see what we can do with this. I don't know the full limitations of this thing. This is the kind of canonical test case of it. This is JSON was here. Now, we need to talk about what Clang actually did, and we're going to hope that future versions of the compiler actually do something a little bit more intelligent. And I will show you. Right here, we have the string JSON was here, and this is this added together thing. It is the appropriate size. Notice there's no zero padding. That's neat. But it's kind of exploded our symbol table. So you can see that the symbol that it loads this pointer to is std underscore underscore one meta reflection v2. Okay, fine. So it's in the reflection namespace. Define static string. Okay, fine. So this is a fixed array inside the reflection namespace. Okay. And it is a fixed array of type car. Sure. And then it is a fixed array of all of those cars. Now, if you've watched this channel for a while, you've seen where we do tricks like this from time to time, where the data is baked into the type. So my string is actually here twice. It's once as this ASCII blob, and it's again in the actual symbol table itself. If I were to make the string, you know, longer, then I'm kind of going to expect to see the symbol name to get longer. And it does in fact appear to have gotten longer. Let's go ahead and play with some other stuff. Let's go ahead and initialize this thing as like, I don't know, a couple of K events or something. And then let's fill it with... Okay, I had to sort out which header it was in. It was in the numeric header, my mistake. So I can create this thing. This is handy. And again, the kind of thing that would have been slightly annoying to do without this helper. I want to see what the symbol is that's created for us here. Fortunately, the compiler slash linker is smart enough to not actually emit this thing if we're not using it. So that's good. Let's go ahead and just write a dummy function that uses it. This thing that's expecting a span and is explicitly not defined is going to have to emit a fair bit of code here for us to actually look at. So we see our array of progressing integers. That's great. That's exactly what we wanted to see. We see that this thing is set up somewhere, and the span is constructed and it's passed a func. That's great. It's a static constexpr thing. And this is just a reminder that we do very much want this thing to be static. If we don't make it static, there is a very non-zero chance that the compiler is going to actually copy that into the local stack space. If Clang doesn't, GCC almost certainly would in this particular case. Let's go ahead and look at this though and see that we do have this symbol table explosion again. So hopefully the final implementation of this makes that better. As I understand it, this doesn't currently work with things like vectors of strings because it doesn't go deep. And I think you need to do that on your own. Okay, very good. So we can actually go ahead and do normal range like thingies with that thing and the call to define static array, which makes sense. I'm cool with that. And we can see only the first 10 elements were actually emitted into the binary. That is what it made static. All right, so there you go. There's also make static object, which I haven't played with at all yet. This is a very welcome addition to the C++ standard library. I am happy to see it come into C++ 26, and I hope that it will make a lot of things easy in the future. We might just have to maybe write some other deep helpers or something around this. We'll see. So thank you for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. Be sure to subscribe. Catch you in the next episode.